topic. I don't think that one lecture will be enough, but I will try to do my best to at least talk about the important parts of congenital heart disease. So the plan is to talk in general about congenital heart disease. After that, we go to talk about five conditions, which are the five most common conditions: VSD, ASD, VDA, coarctation of aorta, and tetralogy of Fallot. And at the end, we will go through the exercise. So, congenital heart disease.
Doctor, I can't see your full whiteboard.
Can't see it.
Yeah, it's not fully captured.
Okay, let me adjust my camera.
Okay.
I think I need to make it higher.
Slightly,
need to make it higher.
Still can't see. Slightly higher.
Okay, let me
bring
another.
Yeah.
Need higher.
Slightly.
Okay.
I still can't see that. Okay. Aduh, terakhir dah belakangan tadi.
How is it now?
Still can't. Still can't see. Still can't see. Sorry. Now can see.
Now you can see.
Yeah. Korang nampak ni?
Okay.
Okay, now.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Doctor.
Thank you, Doctor.
Welcome. Okay. So, congenital heart disease. So, first, we talk about the incidence. Incidence of congenital heart disease. Most of you answered it correct in the exercise. So, it is from 0.5 to 0.8%. Or in other words, you can say 5 to 8 per 1,000 child. So every 1,000 child, they have 5 to 8 children with congenital heart disease. So in fact, congenital heart disease is not rare. It is common. Yeah, congenital heart disease is common. Yeah, you will see. Always when you go to your housemanship, you will see. You will see patients with congenital heart disease. After that, we see what is the most common congenital heart disease. The most common is VSD. VSD. Followed by ASD and VDA. Followed by coarctation of aorta and tetralogy of Fallot. So if they ask you what is the most common congenital cyanotic heart disease, you answer tetralogy of Fallot. If they ask you what is the most common congenital heart disease in general, it is VSD. So obviously 25 to 30% of congenital heart disease. ASD and PDA, 6 to 8%, 6 to 8%, 6 to 8%. Coarctation of aorta and tetragyphal, 5 to 7% of all congenital heart disease. So this is your answer in the exam. What is the most common congenital heart disease? VSD. The most common congenital cyanotic heart disease, tetralogy of Fallot. But the truth is different. You answer like this, yeah. But the truth is different. Why the truth is different? Because there are some conditions which do not appear in childhood and present later in adulthood, like bicuspid aortic valve. When you go to internal medicine, you will see many patients with bicuspid aortic valve, adults. Bicuspid aortic valve. Those with bicuspid aortic valve, many of them remain undiagnosed until adulthood. They develop the symptoms of aortic stenosis, and then they get the management in cardiac surgical ward. So I read one literature before. They did the study on BSD and bicuspid aortic valve. They found bicuspid aortic valve is more common. So in fact, the most common congenital heart disease is bicuspid aortic valve. That is the most common congenital heart disease. It is not VSD. But it's okay. If they ask you in the exam, you answer VSD. It's okay. We accept this answer. Another thing, why this one is not absolutely true, because no one is sure about BDA. Why no one is sure? Because you know BDA is common in premature babies. BDA is common in premature babies. And many premature babies, especially in the rural areas or in the district hospitals, many of them die without diagnosis. Not every premature baby gets echocardiogram. Many premature babies are born in the peripheral hospitals and they die without doing echocardiogram. So that's why these figures are not absolute. Let's go to their six and dress. Six and dress. So it is interesting to know that boys have high incidence of CAD. This is a mnemonic to remember what are the congenital heart disease which are more common in boys. CAD. So boys are CAD. Girls are VIB. But please don't use VIB, girls. Don't be like Western girls. So, CAD, C4, coarctation of aorta, A4, aortic stenosis, and T4, tetralogy of Fallot, and TGA. These are more common in boys. Girls, V is for VSD, A for ASD, P for PDA, and E for endocardial cushion defect. Endocardial cushion defect. So endocardial cushion defect, what is the other name for endocardial cushion defect? Who will tell me what is the other name for endocardial cushion defect? It is Okay, you can type on your answer.
AVSD.
It is AVSD, very good. It is AVSD, atrioventricular septal defect. Another name? It has three names. So, endocardial calcium defect, AVSD, and
complex VSD.
AV canal. AV canal. So, three names. Let's go to the classification. So for classification, remember 2 by 2. So first we classify into acyanotic and cyanotic. Then acyanotic with volume overload and pressure overload. Cyanotic with decreased pulmonary blood flow, or with increased pulmonary blood flow. So four groups, 2 by 2. So when we have volume overload here, usually we have dilatation, chamber dilatation, And when we have pressure overload, we have chamber hypertrophy. For volume overload, we have three categories. We have left to right shunt, left to right shunt. Which condition is? So remember, VAP, the ones which are common in girls, VAP. So VSD, ASD, BDA, and endocardial calcium defect, left to right shunt. Then regurgitant lesions. So any regurgitation, aortic regurgitation, pulmonary regurgitation, regurgitant lesions can cause volume overload. Mitral regurgitation, tricuspid regurgitation, any regurgitant lesion can cause overload, volume overload. The third one is cardiomyopathy. If we come to the other group, pressure overload, we have number one, stenotic lesions. Example of stenotic lesions like aortic stenosis and pulmonary stenosis. These are the famous ones. There is also mitral stenosis and tricuspid stenosis. Number two, coarctation of aorta. And number three, core triteriatum. Core triteriatum means the atrium has three chambers, three small chambers. The atrium is divided. For example, normally you see we have two atria and two veins. If we have four triteriatum, one of the atria will be divided. So there will be three atria. Instead of two atria, there will be three atria. This is called triteriatum. Let's go to the cyanotic. We have cyanotic conditions with decreased pulmonary blood flow and increased pulmonary blood flow. So for decreased pulmonary blood flow, the famous is tetralogy of Fallot, tricuspid atresia, pulmonary atresia, and mixing lesions. Mixing lesions with pulmonary obstruction, with pulmonary obstruction. For conditions with increased pulmonary blood flow, we have TGA, we have TABBR, and we have mixing lesions without pulmonary obstruction. Okay, so this is the classification. Is it clear up to now? Any question about classification?
Assalamualaikum Doktor.
Waalaikumsalam Safira. Yes.
I would like to ask about the cyanotic yang under endocardial cushion defect tu. It is same as AVST. So is it AVST is a common missing that cause cyanosis in children?
See, now if you go and read from sunflower, despite I don't read sunflower, I didn't read it. But I saw it one time with the student, it is classified as cyanotic. This AVST classified as Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes, because I'm using my phone and just now I got one call. That's why I still you cannot see me. Eh?
No.
Why the camera is not coming? I don't know why. Why the
Mr. Try re-enter.
Can you try
re-enter?
What is it? Can I try?
You can try re-enter the link.
Okay. You can see me. Can you see me now?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Fine.
Yes, doctor.
Sorry, because I'm using the phone, and just now I got phone call. So the answer to your question, you see, AVSD, it is asymptomatic. It is asymptomatic congenital heart disease. I saw in sunflower one time they classify it as cyanotic. Yeah, but in fact it is acyanotic. Initially it is acyanotic unless the patient developed Ismail. But the thing sometimes is they classify it as cyanotic for two reasons. Number one, Ismail is very easy to develop very fast, especially in trisomy 21 Down syndrome. So that's why we need to do the operation as early as possible. Number two, they found that some babies initially have mild degree of cyanosis, initially. Why? Because you know, when baby is born, baby has high pulmonary vascular resistance. And after birth, pulmonary vascular resistance will drop. So during the time when there is high pulmonary vascular resistance, the shunt through AVSD may reverse from right to left. So it gives some cyanosis. Once pulmonary vascular resistance fall, it becomes a cyanotic. Is it clear?
Yes, doctor. Thank you, doctor.
Welcome. Any other question about classification?
Doctor, I'd like to ask, do we usually divide the congenital heart disease to duct dependent and non-duct dependent lesion?
You can use it because we know cyanotic congenital heart disease, they are duct dependent. They need the ductus arteriosus to be baited. You need the ductus arteriosus to be baited. Unless you have other communication, like you have other VSD. For example, if you have TGA with VSD or ASD, in that case, you don't need ductus arteriosus. But if you don't have communication, you need ductus arteriosus.
I see. So it's better just to divide based on cyanotic and acyanotic.
Yes.
Oh, okay. Thank you, doctor.
Welcome. Okay. Yes.
What is the difference between chamber dilatation and chamber hypertrophy?
Chamber dilatation, there is a cardiomegaly, while the wall thickness is still the same or slightly increased. Hypertrophy, there is cardiomegaly with increased thickness of the wall. Okay.
Okay, doctor, thank you.
So we go now to the patterns of presentation. Patterns of presentation of congenital heart disease. Patterns of presentation. So was one of the questions in the exercise, and most of you gave good answer. So first pattern is antenatal ultrasound. Antenatal ultrasound.
I'm sorry, doctor, we can't see.
You can see. Okay. Yeah, just. What about
okay.
Now?
Okay.
Okay.
Fine. Thank you.
Welcome. So first battery is antenatal ultrasound. Antenatal ultrasound. Example. Cardiac rhabdomyoma. Cardiac rhabdomyoma. cardiac rhabdomyoma and tuberous sclerosis. So last time I saw one case in UM was diagnosed by antenatal ultrasound. Other congenital heart diseases, you know, ultrasound is operator dependent. Operator dependent. So according to the experience of the obstetrician, some obstetricians who have very good skills, they can visualize the heart of the fetus and they can tell you the diagnosis by antenatal ultrasound. Number two, asymptomatic. So if the patient is asymptomatic, it may be discovered by one of the three ways, either by incidental finding of a murmur. So it happens many times that one baby coming for checkup, then incidentally the doctor find the murmur and refer the patient. Example, hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. Hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy may be asymptomatic until incidental finding of a murmur. Or incidental finding of cardiomegaly on X-ray. Cardiomegaly on chest X-ray. This is also a common scenario, and I saw it twice before. That when baby is admitted to the ward, diagnosis pneumonia, baby is coming with respiratory distress. After that, suddenly, oh, X-ray has cardiomegaly. Then it is dilated cardiomyopathy. Example, dilated cardiomyopathy. Or echo screen. Echo screen. So example, the child has multiple dysmorphic features. Multiple dysmorphic features. Dysmorphic features. The baby has multiple dysmorphic features. Then we have to do screening echo. This screening echo may pick up the congenital heart disease. Number three, heart failure. So patient may present with heart failure. Heart failure, we have four symptoms. And eight signs. So these four symptoms, first symptom is the feeding. For a young infant, it is mainly related to the feeding because they don't do anything. Young infant, just in his mother's lap, just takes feeding. So the symptom must be related to the feeding. Feeding, one of five things. So either it will be reduced or interrupted because we know feeding needs effort. Feeding, this is the only effort baby made. They don't make other efforts. Their effort is in the feeding. So reduced, interrupted or prolonged. Especially in babies who take formula. The mother tell you last time my baby finished 3 ounces in 10 minutes. Now we need 45 minutes to finish. So this is important. Why baby needs long time? Baby needs long time because he cannot make effort to finish in 10 minutes because of his heart. Or induce breathlessness. So the mother tell you, I noticed my baby, nowadays when he takes feeding, he becomes dyslexic. Or very important, don't forget skull sweating. Skull sweating. So these are the five features related to the feeding. So any congenital heart disease from the group which can cause heart failure, if they ask you about the symptoms, so you just, it is the same, whether it is VSD, whether it is BDA, yeah, whether it is TGA. So once you start telling the symptoms, you will tell the same thing. So you can use this as frame for your answer. Number two, effort tolerance. For older children, the mother will tell you, yeah, child has no more effort. Once he moves something, once he plays, start to be distressed. Number three, breathlessness. So even without effort, child may present with breathlessness even at rest. Number four, very important, failure to thrive. Failure to thrive. Many patients with heart failure, they don't thrive. Why? Because the energy is consumed. This tachypnea, this sweating all is consumption of energy. So the child will not thrive well. These are the four symptoms of heart failure. What are the signs? So number one, tachypnea. Number two, tachycardia with possible gallop. Number three, cardiomegaly . Number four, hepatomegaly. Number five. So tachypnea, tachycardia with possible gallop, cardiomegaly, hepatomegaly. What's number five? Failure to thrive. So failure to thrive itself is a symptom and can be a sign. What else? Anyone with you?
How about high pitch crying, doctor?
High pitch crying is not a sign of heart failure.
A sign of heart failure. Oh.
It may happen if you have anomalous left coronary artery. It may happen.
Oh.
Yeah, there will be some ischemic event to the heart. Yeah, but it is not a sign of heart failure.
It's a sign of heart failure.
Cyanosis, Prof, central and peripheral.
Cyanosis is not a sign of heart failure. Cyanosis is a sign of pulmonary hypertension and Eisenmenger.
Can the edema weak
pulses? Yes. So edema can be in the lower limbs in older children, sacral edema in younger children, and can be generalized or anasarca. Okay. Anything related to the right side of the heart in older children, in the neck?
Standard JVP?
Yes, JVP. Raise it. JVP. So this is for right side heart failure in older children. Older children. So one more sign in the lungs. When you auscultate the lungs?
Lung
crepitation. Yes. Crepitation. So say basal crepitations. Bilateral basal crepitation. To make your answer nice, neat. If you say crepitations, it is correct. But if you say bilateral basal crepitations, yeah, you give good impression to the examiner. If you want to give better impression, you say bilateral basal fine crepitation. Bilateral basal fine crepitation. So any condition cause heart failure, when you come and talk about symptoms and signs, you can talk the same thing, whether it is BDA, it is VSD, it is ABSD, it is TGA, the same symptoms. They will not, it is coarctation of aorta. Any condition which cause heart failure will cause these symptoms. So again, we go to back to the presentation. So number one, antenatal ultrasound. Number two, asymptomatic. Number three, heart failure. Number four, cardiogenic shock. Number four, cardiogenic shock. Cardiogenic shock. And obstructive shock. Obstructive shock. So what is cardiogenic shock? If they ask you what are the symptoms and signs of cardiogenic shock, so you mention everything in heart failure. Everything. Cardiogenic shock means everything in heart failure. There, four symptoms, the eight signs are there. Plus, weak pulse volume plus hypotension. Plus weak pulse volume plus hypotension. What about obstructive shock? Obstructive shock will have the same symptoms and signs like cardiogenic shock. This obstructive shock is the one which is duct dependent. Duct dependent. Some conditions, these conditions need to give prostaglandin to open the ductus arteriosus. They present with obstructive shock. There is common presentation at around 2 weeks of life, 2 to 4 weeks. 2 to 4 weeks of life. Baby present with obstructive shock. It is common presentation for coarctation of aorta, critical aortic stenosis, critical aortic stenosis, hypoblastic left heart, hypoblastic left heart, and interrupted aortic arch. Interrupted aortic arch. These four conditions can present with obstructive shock. So again, obstructive shock same, have same symptoms and signs of cardiogenic shock. The difference only terminology. When you say obstructive shock means the main problem is the duct. You need to open the duct. The heart may still have good function. Once you open the duct, you may improve the condition. But when you say cardiogenic shock, means the heart function is already reduced. That's the difference between the two conditions. So again, presentations of congenital heart disease. Number one, antenatal ultrasound. Number two, asymptomatic. Number three, heart failure. Number four, cardiogenic shock and obstructive shock. Number five, syncope. Number six, sudden death. And this was one of the questions in the exercise. So what is the answer? Which condition can be with syncope and sudden death? Which congenital heart disease?
TGA.
Oh, it is not TGA.
Aortic stenosis.
Aortic stenosis, yes.
Aortic stenosis.
Aortic stenosis. So aortic stenosis, that's why it is good. When you diagnose a child with congenital heart disease, yeah, you may save the life. You may save the life of the child, and you may save the quality of the life of the child. Yeah, like this aortic stenosis, so you save them from death. If you diagnose them, it is the only condition, the only congenital heart disease in which we ask for restriction of activity. The only condition we tell the parents restrict activity of the child is aortic stenosis until the operation is done. All the others we don't restrict. We are happy when the children play, when the children active and move around, we are happy with them. We want them to play, we want them to go to the swimming pool, playground, anywhere, except aortic stenosis. Aortic stenosis is the only condition in which you counsel the parents to restrict the activity because of risk of sudden death. Number seven, cyanosis. Cyanosis here, it may come with different patterns. So it may be cyanosis alone. Cyanosis alone means no heart failure. Cyanosis without heart failure, no heart failure. No heart failure. Who can give me example for cyanosis without heart failure? Anyone can tell example?
How about tricuspid atresia, Dr. Topra?
Okay, tricuspid atresia. Tricuspid atresia, tetralogy of Fallot. So any condition with reduced pulmonary blood flow. If you have condition with reduced pulmonary blood flow, you have cyanosis without heart failure. So your answer is correct. Can be tricuspid atresia, can be pulmonary atresia, can be tetralogy of Fallot. Because we have reduced pulmonary blood flow, so we have cyanosis only. So this one, let's say if it is 6 months, if it is 6 months. If we have cyanosis and clubbing, it would be the same condition, the same conditions, but after 6 months. After 6 months. Because before 6 months, there will be no clubbing. There is no clubbing before 6 months. So you see tetralogy of Fallot early, you may not see any signs. Yeah, they will not present early if the pulmonary stenosis is not severe. If you see them at 2 months or like that, they will look fine, completely normal. So at around 6 months or before, they will develop stenosis. After 6 months or after 1 year, they will have the clubbing. The other thing, it may be cyanosis with heart failure. Cyanosis with heart failure. So example for condition for cyanosis with heart failure.
And increase in pulmonary blood flow, such as TGA, TAV,
yes.
Total anaerobic return.
Yes, TABVR, yes. So TGA, for example, TGA, or TABVR, because they have increased pulmonary blood flow. Yes, very good. So these are the common patterns of presentation of congenital heart disease. Let's go to the complications. Complications of congenital heart disease.
Doctor, sorry, I have a question. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
For example, in history taking, how should we describe interrupted feeding?
Interrupted feeding. The mother will tell you the baby is not like before. He takes feeding, then stop. Yeah. And most of the time he will be dyspneic when he stops. Until his dyspnea resolve, then he start taking again. So it will combine together. It will be interrupted and it will be prolonged. And you may see also the scalp sweating, so they may be combined symptoms together.
Okay, thank you, doctor.
Doctor, I have a question.
Yes.
For Ismidahia, for asymptomatic patient, how actually we want to differentiate the murmur is innocent murmur or the pathological murmur?
Okay. Good question. It's right. It may take us away from congenital heart disease, but I'll try to mention it very fast. So when you have murmur, to know whether it is physiological or pathological, you have 10S. 10S. 10S to say it is innocent murmur. Number one, must be soft. So soft, less than or equal 2/6. So if it is 3/6, it is not innocent. Must be less than or equal 2/6. Second S is systolic. Must be systolic. So diastolic murmur is always pathological. Third is sternal edge. Must be around the sternal edge, either the lower sternal edge or the upper sternal edge. Then splitting. Splitting must be normal. If the splitting is abnormal, so your murmur is not innocent murmur. Then must be short. Must be symptom free. Must be symptom free. Special signs. Special signs. The heart rate and blood pressure must be normal. So if you are working in a clinic and you see one patient with murmur, be sure that his blood pressure and his heart rate are normal before you say it is innocent. Then special test. X-ray and ECG must be normal also. So it is reasonable to do chest X-ray and ECG unless you have very good experience and you say it is not needed. Then a change with posture, sitting and standing. Sitting and standing. So for example, the famous still is murmur. It is heard when the patient is lying down. Once the patient sit up or stand up, the intensity of the murmur decrease or disappear. The other thing, sternal depression. Sternal depression, it is known to be associated with innocent murmur. Sternal depression is victus excavatum. Victus excavatum. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. These are the 10 S which tell you the murmur is innocent. Okay?
Okay, thank you, doctor.
Yes? So let's go to complications. Complications of congenital heart disease. Complications. Complications. So complications of acyanotic. For complications of acyanotic, number one, pulmonary hypertension. Pulmonary hypertension because of increased pulmonary blood flow. Number two, recurrent pneumonia. Recurrent pneumonia. Because when we have increased pulmonary blood flow, so there will be flooding of the lung. So it will be good media for bacteria. Number three, heart failure. Number four, infective endocarditis. Number five, Ismail. So is the minger happiness post pulmonary hypertension? You don't have is the minger without pulmonary hypertension. So you need to develop pulmonary hypertension first, then you can go to is the minger. So that's why if you see any patient with pulmonary hypertension, you have to be very careful. You have to be very careful. Tell the parents go to the surgery immediately. Don't wait. Go to your pediatric cardiologist, go to your cardiac surgeon. Yeah, don't wait. Ismail is dangerous. When the patient develops Ismail, means the pulmonary hypertension has increased to a certain limit until it caused damage to the endothelium. When there is damage to the endothelium, there is reversal of the shunt. When the shunt reverses, two things. So, symptoms of heart failure disappear. Symptoms of heart failure disappear. Heart failure disappear. Number two, murmur also disappear. But unfortunately, the patient becomes cyanotic. Patient becomes cyanotic. Because the shunt reverse, it became right to left. So, unfortunately, when a patient goes to Ismail, what is the treatment for Ismail? Who tell me what is the treatment for Ismail? Lung transplantation from North Africa. Yes, it is heart and lung transplantation. Not only lung, not only heart. Heart and lungs transplantation. So imagine how to do that. Even in the most developed countries, it is not easy. So almost impossible to do it. So please don't let your patient go to Ismail. Let's go to the complications of cyanotic.
Doctor, doctor,
I have yes?
a question. My name mm-hmm. is you. How can cyanotic can lead to infective endocarditis?
How a cyanotic can lead to infective endocarditis? Okay. When you have defect. When you have defect, so you have turbulent flow. Turbulent flow. This turbulent flow enhance stasis of bacteria. So normally, we don't have bacteria in our blood. Normally, we don't have bacteria. And our flow is laminar flow. But when there is defect in the heart, okay, there is no bacteria, but the flow is turbulent. In case that bacteria gets excess, for example, dental procedure, example, dental procedure, because you know the mouth is full of bacteria, and then you go to the dentist. In case that bacteria find the way to enter the blood, then it finds stasis, then it will cause the infection. So that's why we give prophylaxis. If you see any patient with congenital heart disease comes to you and wants to go for dental, you give prophylaxis against infective endocarditis. You give antibiotic before the procedure. Despite now there are new researches, they tell them there is no benefit, but we still teach the basic. IGN is still practice. IGN until 2018, they still practice giving prophylactic antibiotic. Okay? Okay, fine. Let's go to complications of cyanotic. Cyanotic congenital heart disease. So first complication is stroke. They may develop stroke because of thrombosis. Stroke because of thrombosis. Who will tell me why congenital cyanotic heart disease they develop stroke? Why? What is the risk in them to make stroke happen? Cyanotic congenital heart disease. Hyperviscosity, very good. Yes, I see the answer from, okay, the name disappeared. So hyperviscosity, why hyperviscosity? Yes, tell me why hyperviscosity, because of?
Polycythemia.
Because of polycythemia, yes, very good. They have hyperviscosity because of polycythemia. Why they have polycythemia?
Body produce more blood to carry out oxygen.
Very good, yes. Compensatory mechanism for hypoxia. Because they have chronic hypoxia, they will have compensatory mechanism. Their bone marrow produce more RBCs. So that's why we have polycythemia. Number two, they develop also infective endocarditis. Endocarditis. And number three, they develop cerebral abscess. Cerebral abscess. Cerebral abscess comes after infective endocarditis. You cannot have cerebral abscess without infective endocarditis. So they develop infective endocarditis first, then infective endocarditis leads to cerebral abscess. Why? Because they have right to left shunt. So that septic emboli go to the brain. Normally, let's say a patient does not have cyanotic congenital heart disease, he develops infective endocarditis. Normally, cerebral abscess will not happen. Why? Because the emboli will go to the lung, and the lung function as a filter. The lung filters this emboli. So it will not reach the brain. But those with cyanotic congenital heart disease, like tetralogy of Fallot, so they have right to left shunt. So there's access to the brain through the systemic circulation without passage through the lung. So no filtration. These are the complications of cyanotic congenital heart disease. Let's go to the investigations for congenital heart disease in general. So any case, they ask about VSD, AST, BDA. What investigation is needed? 1, 2, 3, it is screened for work. So chest X-ray, ECG, echocardiogram. Number 4, cardiac catheterization. Number 5, others. So, when you tell about chest X-ray, you need to tell about heart size, you need to tell about pulmonary vascularity, and you need to tell if any special battery. Special battery. ECG, you need to tell about axis, you need to tell about hypertrophy, and any special pattern, any special pattern. These are the basic investigations needed for congenital heart disease. What is the treatment for congenital heart disease? Treatment. So we take the frame of treatment, then we apply for any case. They ask you, use that frame for answer. So treatment of congenital heart disease. Number 1, if needed. If needed, emergency prostaglandin. Prostaglandin. Emergency prostaglandin if needed. Number 2, prophylaxis. Against infective endocarditis. Infective endocarditis. Number 3, nutritional care. Nutritional care. Because we know congenital heart disease, it may cause failure to thrive. So you need nutritional care. You may need even the dietitian to help you. So you need nasogastric tube. Why nasogastric tube? Because if I let the baby take my mouth, he would be tired, exhausted. So I use nasogastric tube. So the milk will go to the baby while he's relaxed. Even if breastfeeding, I can ask the mother to express and give by the NGT. And I need to add calories. Add calories. So either human milk fortifier or glucose or medium chain triglycerides, MCT, anything to add calories. Because we need calories, we need the baby to gain weight. Then we can go for surgery if needed. You know, surgeons and anesthetists, they need 10 kilograms. They need 10 kilograms to go for operation. They will not go before 10 kilograms unless it is real emergency. So you mentioned about nutritional care. You can consider dietitian. Dietitian can help. It is good. If you answer in the exam, you mentioned that I may need the help of dietitian. It will give good impression to the examiner. Number 4. Medical and surgical treatment. But it is good to mention that you refer. Especially in postgraduate exams, like Royal College exams, when you talk about medical treatment or surgical treatment for congenital heart disease, they prefer that you mention refer to pediatric cardiologist. refer to pediatric cardiologist and cardiac surgeon. And cardiac surgeon for medical treatment, of heart failure if any heart failure and surgical treatment if needed. Surgical treatment if needed. So if you have heart failure, you cannot go for surgery. You must treat the heart failure first, then you go for surgery. So this is the frame of management of congenital heart disease, either PDA, ASD, VSD, tetralogy of Fallot. So always just use this frame in your answer. We see later when we go condition one by one, we will go through this frame. Post operative complications, post operative complications number one, pleural effusion and the pneumothorax. Pleural effusion and pneumothorax. So that's why, unfortunately now, you don't go to the wards. But if you go to the ward, especially in HKL, when they have many, many patients with cardiac conditions, you see many patients in their chest, like they have scar in the midline here, then one dot here, one dot here, one dot here. Yeah, so obviously let's ask why. Patient has one dot here, one dot. These are all insertion points. Drainage points means the patient has complications, either pleural effusion or pneumothorax, and required to drain. That's why you see multiple circular scars. Number two, pericardial effusion. Pericardial effusion. Number three, arrhythmia. Number four, kylothorax. Kylothorax. Kylothorax because of damage to thoracic duct. Number five, vocal cord palsy. Because of damage to recurrent laryngeal nerve. Number six, Horner syndrome. Who will tell me what is Horner syndrome? Yeah, someone tell me what is Horner syndrome? Did you hear about Horner syndrome? Okay.
It's actually when there is a meiosis, ptosis, and also in hydrosis.
Very good, very good. Yes, I saw the answer written and I hear the answer now. Yes. So when there is meiosis, ptosis, and ipsilateral hydrosis. Why Horner syndrome? Because of damage. To cervical sympathetic trunk. So if we damage the thoracic duct, we have kylothorax. If we damage recurrent laryngeal nerve, we have vocal cord palsy. If we have damage in cervical sympathetic trunk, we will have Horner syndrome. So again, if they ask you what are the post operative complications of BSD, so just go to this list. It is all post operative complications: PDA, this one. Most of the complicated coarctation of aorta, extra-arterial fibril, it is this one. So just use it as a frame, use for any condition. Any question up to here?
I would like to ask, what do we give emergency prostaglandin?
Okay, good. This is a very good question. This is a very practical question. You see, if you see any newborn with cyanosis and you confirm that it is not respiratory cyanosis, you start prostaglandin, even without echocardiogram. I know because you may face myself when I was in my country. So I was the head of pediatric intensive care unit, that babies with cyanosis, they will come to me. But we don't have good echo machine and pediatric cardiologist is not easily available. So once we see cyanotic baby, immediately we start prostaglandin. And when we get the chance to call the pediatric cardiologist, first advice, once we call first advice, before he asks, before he takes testing from us, he will say, did you start prostaglandin? Yeah. So this is the first thing. Always when you see baby with cyanosis and you confirm it is not respiratory, start prostaglandin to keep ductus arteriosus open. How to know it is not respiratory? Can you tell me how to know it is not respiratory cyanosis?
Maybe the...
Yes, so hyperoxia test, the one which can differentiate between cardiovascular cyanosis and respiratory cyanosis. Another thing you'll notice, usually if cyanosis is without heart failure, the patient will be not tired, the patient will be happy, fine. Blue, and because there is no heart failure, so the patient will be happy. Like if you see severe tetralogy of Fallot, yeah, severe form which present early. So you see the baby is blue, but he is not tachypneic because he has no heart failure. Okay, but your answer always hyperoxia test. Any other question?
Doctor, regarding TGA, is it possible for TGA to have a decreased pulmonary blood flow?
If TGA has the pulmonary stenosis, because TGA, it can come with pulmonary stenosis. Yeah, if TGA has pulmonary stenosis, there will be reduced pulmonary blood flow.
All right, so in that case, patient may not have the symptoms of heart failure.
Yes. Yeah, exactly. When the pulmonary blood flow is reduced, you don't see the symptoms of heart failure.
All right, thank you.
Assalamualaikum, doctor.
Assalam.
I'd like to ask about there's this circulation called ductus dependent circulation, and I don't really understand about why there is presence of ductus dependent circulation in certain types of congenital heart disease.
Ductus dependent condition. You see, because the patient, if you have TGA, for example, or let's say you have TABVR. Yeah. So, okay. Let's say this is TGA. So this is the pulmonary artery. TGA means pulmonary artery will come from the left. So if you have TGA, this is the pulmonary artery from the left. And the aorta from the right. So this is aorta, this is pulmonary artery. This is left ventricle. And this is right ventricle. So now, let's say take the circulation. Let's say the blood comes. The blood comes by superior vena cava. Superior vena cava. So the blood will come here. It will go through tricuspid valve. Tricuspid valve. Then it will go down here. So after that, it will go by the aorta. It will go to the systemic. Now the problem, if you don't have BDA, how to get the blood in the pulmonary? And how to put the blood in the left atrium? No blood will come here. So the blood will go, aorta will go to the systemic circulation. Systemic circulation will bring the blood again here. So nothing will come here. So that's why you need ductus arteriosus. You need ducts. So when you have ductus, the blood will come here to the pulmonary. Once blood comes to the pulmonary, from the lungs, it will come by the pulmonary veins. Pulmonary veins. It will come here. Then through the mitral valve. And will go again by the pulmonary artery. So you need it. Without it, the patient cannot survive. Because no blood will come to the pulmonary circulation without ductus arteriosus. That's why we call it ductal dependent. This condition we call it ductal dependent pulmonary blood flow. Pulmonary blood flow. Ductal dependent pulmonary blood flow. Is it clear?
Yeah, thank you.
Welcome. Any other question? Okay, no question. Now we go to congenital heart diseases one by one. We will start with VSD. It will be easy now because now you have the frame. You have the frame. We'll go through the frame one by one. So for every congenital heart disease, I will talk about 10 points. We'll take them one from number one to number 10. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Every condition. So number one, tibus. Tibus, or we can say definition. Definition and tibus. Definition and tibus. Number two, incidence. And six. Number three, associated conditions. Associated conditions. Number four, clinical presentation. And physical examination. Number five, complications. Number six, chest X-ray. Number seven, ECG. Number 8, echo. Number 9, cardiac catheterization. Number 10, others. Or other investigations, if needed. Other investigations. Okay. And number 11, treatment and the prognosis. Can you see? Treatment and prognosis. Treatment and prognosis. So, definition and types, incidence and sex, associated conditions, Before the clinical presentation, it is good to talk about pathophysiology. Pathophysiology. Yeah, then will be the clinical presentation and physical examination. Number 6 will be complications. 7 will be the chest X-ray. 8 ECG. 9 echo. 10 cardiac catheterization. 11 any others, and 12 treatment and prognosis. So 12 points for every congenital heart disease. So let's start with VSD. VSD, ventricular septal defect. Ventricular septal defect. So let's talk the first one. Definition and types. What is the definition? The name tell you. It is defect in the septum. Communication between right and left. Communication between right and left ventricles. Types. Two main types. Number one, membranous. And number two, muscular. So number one, membranous. And number two, muscular. Membranous is more common. This one is more common. More common. Muscular less common, but more chance to close spontaneous. Less common, but more chance to close spontaneous. So the membrane is divided into supracrystal and infracrystal. So infracrystal is more common. Supracrystal, this one, it may impinge to the aortic valve. It may touch the aortic valve and cause aortic insufficiency. It may have aortic insufficiency. That is supracrystal. It is considered rare compared with infracrystal. Supracrystal is rare. Muscular, we have either single or Swiss cheese. Swiss cheese, we call it Roger. Multiple small holes, they call it Swiss cheese. So these are the types of VSD. The incidence at 6, you tell me now. What is the incidence of VSD? How much from congenital heart disease? What is 25. The percentage of VSD?
25 to 30%, doctor.
25 to 30%, very good. Tell me the 6, is it more in girls or boys?
More in girls, wait.
Girls.
Vape, yes, girls take vape in girls, yes, vape. So it is more in girls. Yeah, so VSD is more in girls. Okay, associated condition is, it is associated with pulmonary stenosis and tetralogy of Fallot. VSD is associated with pulmonary stenosis and tetralogy of Fallot. Let's go to the pathophysiology. Pathophysiology. Okay, so the pathophysiology. The pathophysiology depends on size of the defect. Size and pressure gradient. Pressure gradient. Size of the defect and pressure gradient. Size and pressure gradient. Size and pressure gradient. So, if the defect is small, if the defect is small, less than 5 millimeter, the shunt will be minimal. It will be left to right. Goes to the pulmonary artery. Go to the lungs, then come from there, pulmonary veins. Here. So, then it comes to the left ventricle and goes to the aorta. So, if less than 5 millimeter, shunt is minimal shunt. And no change in chamber size. No change in chamber size. No change in chamber size. So the patient will be normal, maybe missed until incidental finding of a murmur. And most of the time, if it is small, it will close spontaneously. So the pediatric cardiologist and cardiac surgeon will just keep follow up the child and it will close spontaneously. If the shunt, if the defect is big, if the defect is big, more than 1 millimeter, more than 1 millimeter, here the shunt will be higher, the shunt will be more. Unless there is high pulmonary vascular resistance. So another factor which contribute to the flow is the pulmonary vascular resistance. So normally, pulmonary vascular resistance is normal. You'll have high shunt. You'll have high shunt. So high blood coming to the left side. So what will happen? The left ventricle will enlarge. It will get some hypertrophy, but we said when we have volume overload, it is dilatation more than hypertrophy. If we have pressure overload, hypertrophy more than dilatation. So some hypertrophy may happen, but mainly dilatation. So the first chamber, first chamber affected in VSD is the left ventricle. It is affected before the right ventricle. Left ventricle is affected first. So,
doctor?
Yes?
Doctor, sorry, is it more than 1 millimeter? Because the snow is far less than 5 millimeter, isn't it?
Sorry, more than 1 centimeter.
Okay. Thank you, doctor.
Thank you. Yes, more than 1 centimeter. It is more than 1 centimeter, yes, not 1 millimeter. So the defect is more than 1 centimeter. Like I said, the shunt will be high. The blood will go to the lungs will be flooded. Then blood will come by the pulmonary veins to the left atrium, to the left ventricle. So left ventricle is the first will be affected. And you know Frank Starling law, when the left ventricle gets more blood, so it will work higher until a certain point of time, the left ventricle will fail. So when the left ventricle fail, we also develop right ventricular failure, because the left ventricle, if it is not working well, there will be congestion in the lungs. This congestion in the lungs will lead to pulmonary hypertension. And then the right ventricle has to dilate, some hypertrophy also, and dilate to push the blood. With time, when we have pulmonary hypertension, what will happen? Pulmonary hypertension. With time, there will be degeneration of endothelial cells. Degeneration. Which will reach this stage? Degeneration. When we have degeneration of endothelial cells, what will happen to the shunt? The shunt will reverse. The shunt will reverse. And here we have Ismail. Ismail. And unfortunately, it is late. Your patient shouldn't go to Ismail. So what will happen when the patient go to Ismail? Tell me the changes, the clinical changes. I mentioned in the frame. What will happen? What will happen to the murmur? What will happen to the signs of heart failure? Yes?
The symptom of heart failure will disappear. The murmur will disappear. Patient will become cyanotic.
Very good. Yes, very good. And what is the treatment for Eisenmenger?
Heart and lung transplantation.
Heart and lung transplantation. So our patient shouldn't go to Eisenmenger. This is the pathophysiology of VSP. So let's go to the clinical presentation and physical signs. So clinical presentation, it may be asymptomatic. So if it is small, it will be asymptomatic. But the murmur will be loud. So that's the thing. When you have a small defect, the patient may be asymptomatic, but the murmur will be louder. Why? Because turbulence. Turbulence, the murmur is produced by turbulence flow. So as you have smaller defect, you have more turbulent flow. So louder murmur. Opposite of that, large defect. When you have large defect, you have less turbulent flow, but you will develop pulmonary hypertension and you will develop heart failure. If the defect is large, the patient will present with heart failure. Heart failure. Usually BSD, they present at around 3 months, like that. 3 months. They don't present at birth with heart failure. They present at around 3 months. Some of them even up to 6 months. So tell me what symptoms they will develop. What will happen to their feeding? Tell me. Go to the frame and tell me what will happen.
It will be reduced, interrupted. Reduced,
interrupted.
Prolonged.
Prolonged, very good.
Induced breathlessness. And also
induced breathlessness, yes.
Scalp sweating.
Scalp sweating, very good. Okay, so these are the symptoms which happen to the child. These are the symptoms which happen to the child. So what physical signs we will see when you do physical examination? So just go to the frame. What are the signs of heart failure?
Tachypnea,
tachycardia.
Tachycardia
with possible gallop.
Cardiomegaly, hepatomegaly.
So you can't tell. We can say deviated apex beat or displaced apex beat. So how will the apex beat change? Will it go downward or it will go lateral? What is the first change? Will it go downward or lateral? How it goes?
Lateral.
First, it goes downward. Mm-hmm. After that, it goes lateral. Why? Because first chamber affected is the left ventricle. When the left ventricle is affected, when the left ventricle enlarges, so the heart will go down. The apex beat will deviate down. When the right ventricle enlarges, the apex beat will go lateral. So initially, the left ventricle first, so it will go downward first. After that, with time, if the patient develops biventricular failure, it will go downward and lateral. What is the normal location of apex beat in young children? Who will tell me normal location? Which intercostal space?
Fourth intercostal space.
Yeah, very good, very good. Your answer is correct. It is fourth intercostal space. Yes. So in internal medicine, in adults, it is fifth intercostal space. But in pediatric, it is fourth intercostal space in cross with midclavicular line. So this is the clinical presentation and physical examination of patients with VSD. Okay, let's go to the complications. Okay, tell me complications of VSD. You go to the frame. Yeah. So what is the first complication of acyanotic heart disease? In your frame?
Hypertension.
Hypertension. Does it happen in VSD?
Yes.
Yes. Second complication?
Recurrent pneumonia.
Recurrent pneumonia, does it happen?
Yes.
Third complication?
Heart failure.
Does it happen?
Yes.
Fourth complication?
IE. Infected.
IE. And it happened. Fifth complication?
It's an anger.
And it happened. So you see, it is easy to answer now. So just mention all of them. All complications can happen. Now let's go to the chest X-ray. So chest X-ray, we said, we comment on the heart size and we comment on the pulmonary vascularity and if any special changes. Okay, chest X-ray, if the VSD is small, less than 5 millimeter, what do you expect the heart size?
Normal.
Normal. If large, VSD? Cardiomegaly. Very good. Okay, then pulmonary vascularity. If it's small, VSD, what do you expect?
No changes.
No changes. If large VSD, increased pulmonary vascularity. So when we have pulmonary vascularity, the lung will be whiter. Plethoric lung. Plethoric. The lung will be plethoric. whiter. If the lung is oligemic, it will be black. If the lung is oligemic, it will be black. When we have reduced pulmonary blood flow, when we have oligemic lung. But here we have increased pulmonary blood flow, so we have bleating lung. Okay. There are no special changes, no special signs. Let's go to the ECG. So if small VSD, we expect normal ECG. Small VSD, normal ECG. If large VSD, what do we expect?
Hypertrophy.
Hypertrophy, very good. Which chamber will hypertrophy first?
Left, and then right. Left.
Yes, left. So left chamber will hypertrophy first. Do you know what are the signs of hypertrophy in ECG?
It will increase in the R volume.
Which leads?
R height at V6, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes, you are right. Very good. Very good. Yes, very good. Yes, your answer is correct. So if the VSD is advanced, you see enlargement in all the chambers. Yeah, initially the left ventricle, after that, left atrium, after that, right atrium and right ventricle. So all will enlarge if we don't manage our patient. And every chamber enlargement has certain signs. So like you said if the left ventricle is enlarged, you will see high R wave in the left ventricular leads, like V6. Yeah. If left atrium is enlarged, so this is important in internal medicine, be mitral. Be mitral. We call it be mitral. So the B wave, this is normal B wave. Normal B wave. When we have B mitral, it is like this. We call it B mitral, it is like M. This indicates left atrium hypertrophy. Left atrium hypertrophy. If right atrium is enlarged, we will have B pulmonary. If right atrium enlarged, we'll have B pulmonary. B pulmonary is like this. B pulmonary. So when the right ventricle enlarges, what sign you will see if the right ventricle gets enlarged? What we'll see in the ECG? If both ventricles are enlarged, it will be difficult because you know the left ventricle causes enlargement of the left leads, R wave in the left leads, and large S wave in the right leads. When you have right ventricular hypertrophy, you have increased R wave in the right leads and S wave in the left leads. So the both defects may overlap with each other and you cannot detect. But there is very, very important sign for right ventricular enlargement that will not be affected, which is T wave. T wave in V1. T wave in V1. In lead V1. Normally, T wave in first week of life, is upright. Normally, it is upright in first week. From 1 week to 14 years, normally it is inverted. It is inverted. So the T wave should be inverted from 1 week to 14 years. If 1 week to 14 years, you see T wave is not inverted, this means right ventricular hypertrophy. Right ventricular hypertrophy. Okay. Then we go to the echo. Echo. So for echo, we check the size. We check the pressure. Gradient. and we check the heart function, ejection fraction. Ejection fraction, EF is ejection fraction, heart function. Is the heart still functioning well or no? And we check the aortic valve, aortic valve. Why aortic valve? Because remember, when we classify VSD into membranous and muscular. Membranous two types. One is infracrystal, which is more common, and one is supracrystal, which may touch the aortic valve and cause aortic incompetence. So that's why you need to look at the aortic valve. Cardiac catheterization. Is it necessary? Can you tell me, is it necessary to do cardiac catheterization for VSD? Can someone tell me? Is it needed? Okay, you can. Yes.
No.
Very good. Your answer is correct. Yes. Cardiac catheterization is not needed for VSD. Okay. Do we need any other investigation?
No.
Yes, we don't need any other investigation. Very good. We don't need any other investigation. Now, okay. AFAF is AFAF here. Can you tell me the treatment for VSD? What is the treatment?
The treatment for VSD.
So go to the frame.
If now, needed. If needed, emergency prostaglandin.
Okay, do you think we need in VSD emergency prostaglandin?
No.
No, very good. Your answer is correct. We don't need emergency prostaglandin. So okay. What do we need?
Prophylaxis against IE.
Very
and
good.
And then nutritional care. We can give nasogastric or add calories and refer to the dietitian.
Very
and
good.
Last but not least, refer to the pediatric cardiologist and cardiac surgeon.
Very good. We refer to pediatric cardiologist and cardiac surgeon. So pediatric cardiologist to manage heart failure, if there is any heart failure, with anti-failure medications like diuretics and ACE inhibitors, spironolactone, and cardiac surgeon to go for surgery. To go for surgery. So the surgery is needed if the patient has ongoing heart failure, not controlled, or the defect is large. Then we have to do the surgery. Yes. Be sure your patient doesn't go to pulmonary hypertension, doesn't go to pulmonary vascular disease. You have to be careful. Yeah. So if the VSD is not closed, patient still has ongoing heart failure, large defect, go for surgical closure.
Doctor, because patient can get recurrent pneumonia, can we give a vaccination to the for management?
Very good. Yes, correct. Yeah, you will impress the examiner. Yes, it is indicated. For the vaccination, it is indicated. When you go talk about monoclonal antibodies for respiratory syncytial virus, about influenza vaccine, pneumococcal vaccine, yes, it is recommended. It is recommended. Very good. Yes, correct answer. Yes. It is recommended to give the vaccinations, and you can mention in the management part. So, surgical correction, sometimes you see surgeons to go for surgery, cardiac surgeons and anesthetists, they need 10 kilogram. They need 10 kilogram. But sometimes the heart failure is difficult to control. Yeah, they increase the medications, you reduce the full fluid intake, because we know high fluid intake will worsen heart failure. So you need to reduce the fluid intake. The problem when you reduce the fluid intake, you will have less calories. So sometimes there is a struggle. When you increase the calories, increase the volume a bit, patient goes to heart failure. Heart failure, dyspnea, then lose weight again. Increase the medications of heart failure. Patient improve, but still not gaining weight. You increase the feeding, patient develop heart failure again. So we stay in struggle. And patient does not gain weight well. So in that case, is there any solution we can do before closure of VSD? any operation which is not difficult, easy, does not need long time.
We can bend it.
Yes, yes, yes. What is it?
Bending.
Yes, very good. Pulmonary artery bending. Pulmonary artery bending. Yes. Pulmonary artery bending. Very good. So, pulmonary artery bending will constrict the pulmonary, so you will have reduced pulmonary blood flow. When you have reduced pulmonary blood flow, your heart failure will improve. When the heart failure improves, your patient will gain weight. When the patient gain weight, you can go for VSD closure. Okay, so tell me, what are the post-operative complications? Yeah, who will tell me what are post-operative complications? Go to the frame. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Pleural effusion and pneumothorax.
Pleural effusion and pneumothorax. Very good. Number two.
Pericardial effusion, arrhythmia, cyclothorax, vocal cord palsy, and Horner syndrome.
Very good. Yes, these are the complications. These are the complications. Pleural effusion and the pneumothorax. Pericardial effusion, arrhythmia, cyclothorax, and vocal cord palsy and Horner syndrome. These are the complications. Prognosis. What is the prognosis of VSD? Good or poor?
Good.
Good. Yeah, the prognosis is good. So many, most of the small VSD close spontaneously. Small VSDs close spontaneously, and most operative prognosis and the quality of life is excellent. So that's all about VSD. Any question about VSD?
Doctor, yes. Just now I don't catch up regarding the wave, the T wave in V1 led in VSD. Whether it's inverted in what, by what age you say it is VSD.
Okay. B wave in normal children, T wave in normal children. T wave in normal children. First week, T wave in normal children in V1. This feature of lead V1, not the other leads. First week, it is upright. This is normal. From 1 week to 14 years, it is inverted. More than 14 years, like us, it is upright. So if we do ECG for any one of us, it will be upright. So during this age, from 1 week to 14 years, if you find T wave upright, this means it is right ventricular hypertrophy.
Okay, get it. Thank you.
Welcome. Any other question about VSD?
Assalamu alaikum, doctor. I would like to ask about the type of murmur in VSD and also the S2 splitting that occurs in VSD.
Type of the murmur and?
S2 splitting. Splitting of the second heart sound.
Yeah, okay, fine. So type of the murmur. It is band systolic murmur. Band systolic murmur in the left lower sternal edge. Left lower sternal edge. So band systolic murmur, if we have this one here, and we have this two here. So the murmur will be uniform in shape. Uniform. This is the murmur, obviously. So this is the initial murmur. If, let's say, your patient was kept, would he be his BSD? And your patient developed pulmonary hypertension, increased pulmonary flow, increased pulmonary flow. So you expect ejection systolic murmur to happen. You may expect ejection systolic murmur. Ejection systolic murmur, if happen, is crescendo decreasing. So this is this one, and this is this two. So the murmur will be crescendo decreasing. Crescendo decreasing. So it will indicate, in this case, pulmonary hypertension. Increase pulmonary flow. Increase pulmonary flow. Because pulmonary hypertension, when it is not Ismail yet, you have increased pulmonary flow. So you expect to see ejection systolic murmur. But it will not be in the same place. It will be high. It will be in the upper, left upper, left upper sternal edge. Because it is not due to valve lesion, it is due to increased pulmonary flow. After that, if still VSD was not managed well, another murmur will appear, which is due to flow in the mitral valve. Because you see, we have shunt from left ventricle to right ventricle, go to the pulmonary artery, then it will come to the left atrium and go down to the left ventricle. So the mitral valve has large volume coming in it. So if the mitral valve has large volume, you will have mid diastolic murmur, which is very difficult. Yeah. Clinically, mid-diastolic murmur is the most difficult murmur to appreciate. And when you have mid-diastolic murmur, it is very dangerous. Means your pulmonary hypertension is very high. You are going to go to Ismail. You have to be very careful. Your patient shouldn't reach that stage. So this is regarding the murmurs. Regarding the splitting. So, normal first and second half sound is S1 and S2. Normally, loop two. So, when we have splitting, we have loop the two. So, this one is splitted. Why is it written? This there is the pulmonary component. Pulmonary. And this one is aortic. This one is aortic. This one is aortic. And this one is pulmonary. That is the normal splitting. The normal splitting. It is not easy to pick up by stethoscope, but normally, if we breathe, it is more during inspiration, louder during inspiration. Ask the patient to breathe, take deep breathing, you will hear it more. Why this splitting happens during inspiration? Because you see, when you have inspiration, you have increased diameter of the chest wall. increase diameter of the chest wall will make intrathoracic pressure more negative. So less intrathoracic pressure. When you have less intrathoracic pressure, you will have more venous return. More venous return. When you have more venous return, so the pulmonary, the lung will be full. There will be pooling of blood in the lungs. Because you have negative pressure, the blood will pool here in the lungs. So what will happen to the pulmonary artery? It will close after the aorta. They will not close at the same time. When pulmonary artery close after aorta, you will hear the door. So that's the normal one. When you have VSD, when you have VSD, what will happen to the pulmonary flow? Will it be increased or decreased, pulmonary flow? It is increasing. So what will happen to the closure of the pulmonary? Will it be delayed or earlier? It will be delayed. Yes. So in this case, you'll have wider splitting. Wider splitting. Enhanced splitting, splitting, which is more during inspiration. Is it clear?
Yes, doctor. Thank you.
Welcome. Any other question? Okay, if no other question, let's go to that. Yes, yes.
Thank you, doctor. My name is Anis.
Okay, yes.
So I want to ask for the muscular type of VSD, the defect, some more of the defect stop close spontaneously, right, doctor?
Yes, yes. So
at what age we expect them to close spontaneously?
Okay, most of them close by the school age. Yeah, most of them close by the school age and even close earlier. Some of them by first year, second year, they close. Yeah. If you read from some references, they tell you some even persisted longer, even after childhood. They're still not closed, but when they reach adulthood, it will be completely closed.
Okay, thank you, doctor.
Doctor, you mentioned before that there is a Swiss cheese type of VSD.
Yes.
So does multiple defect have any macam difference in terms of closure? I mean, whether is indicated for early surgery for multiple defects?
I didn't see any reference telling that multiple Swiss cheese has difference from the other single muscular. I didn't see.
All right, thank you.
So let's go to ASD. So again, we have the frame. So we start with definition and types. Definition, it is atrial septal defect. Defect in the atrial septum. Defect in the atrial septum. Types, we have four types. Number one, ostium primum. Ostium primum. So ostium primum will be here in the lower part. It will be in the lower part. Ostium primum in the lower part of interatrial septum. And they found that there is cleft in the mitral valve. There is mitral valve cleft. Cleft in mitral valve. So this type is considered variant of AVSD. Because it is down here, and in combination with the cleft in the mitral valve, there may be some communication between the atria and ventricles. So that's why, in fact, ostium primum, it is AVSD rather than ASD. So I will not talk about it. I will talk about the other types. The common type is ostium secundum. Ostium secundum. Ostium secundum is in the middle. In the area of foramen ovale. The third is sinus venosus. Sinus venosus. Sinus venosus. Sinus venosus, it is near either superior vena cava or inferior vena cava. So it will be either sinus venosus. It will be either here or here, near superior vena cava or inferior vena cava. The fourth type, you call it unroofed coronary sinus. It is not common, unroofed coronary sinus. Which is somewhere down here, down also, roofed coronary sinus. These are the four types of ASD. Incidence. So tell me, what is the incidence of ASD among other congenital heart disease?
6 to 8%.
Yeah, so 6 to 8%. Is it more in girls or boys?
Girls,
girls. Yes. Associated conditions. What conditions are associated with ASD? So if you have sinus venosus, it may be associated with PABVR. Partial anomalous pulmonary venous return. Partial anomalous pulmonary venous return. If you have ostium secundum, it may be associated with Holt-Oram syndrome. Holt-Oram syndrome. Holt-Oram. Holt-Oram, they have skeletal anomaly. They have absent thumb. Typically, they have absent thumb or absent radius, and they have ASD. Let's go to the pathophysiology. Pathophysiology of ASD. Okay, so the blood will flow from left atrium to right atrium, go to tricuspid valve, and ascend in this direction to the pulmonary artery. So most of the time, ASD is not like VSD. Most of the time, it will not cause heart failure. Most of the time, it will be asymptomatic. Why? Because the shunt is not big. The ASD, there is no high pressure communication. If you look at VSD, and VSD, the blood was going direct from left ventricle to right ventricle. So there's high kinetic energy, But now in ASD, when the blood go by this direction, there is loss of kinetic energy. Loss of kinetic energy. And there is no high pressure communication. This area high pressure, the left ventricle, is not communicated with the right ventricle. No high pressure communication and loss of kinetic energy. So that's why the defect most of the time is mild and tolerated, and will not, even some adults grow with this defect. So usually they classify small ASD as 3 to 6 millimeter, moderate 6 to 12 millimeter, moderate, and large more than 12 millimeter. So here different from VSD. Remember VSD, because there was high pressure communication from left ventricle to right ventricle. Left ventricle was affected first because there was high kinetic energy and high pressure communication. Here in this case, in ASD, left ventricle will not be affected. The effect will be on the right ventricle state. So there will be pulmonary hypertension, but this one will not happen very fast. Will happen after a long time. If the defect is large and we didn't diagnose, we did discover early, then it may happen. So patient will have pulmonary hypertension, increased flow, and right atrial enlargement, and some hypertrophy. Pulmonary hypertension. In case that the patient is unlucky, the defect is very large, pulmonary hypertension was not treated, then again there will be degeneration. Degeneration of endothelial cells, of pulmonary artery, and this will lead to reversal of the shunt and Ismail mingle. So when you tell that in the exam, you have to say it is uncommon. Yeah, tell the examiner, let the examiner knows that you know that this is uncommon. Uncommon to develop heart failure, uncommon to develop Ismail mingle. Most of the time it is asymptomatic.
Okay. Doctor, can I ask you a question?
Yes.
I understand why degeneration of cells in the pulmonary artery will cause the reversal of the shunt.
Mm-hmm. Why? Okay. This is shear stress. This high flow causes shear stress, which is important to keep laminar flow when the cells are normal. So your flow is laminar. But in this case, when you have the degeneration, the cells become thickened and they lose their ability to keep the laminar flow. So I give you example. Let me give you example from life. Like if you have this flow in smooth pipe. But then with the time, if the pipe becomes not smooth and becomes rusted. But the thing is not the same. Still, the physiology of the endothelial cells is not like the pipe, because the pipe even with rust, still the flow will be straight. Yeah, it may be not laminar, yes, but still it will be straight. Here, maybe I will go and find out why this degeneration of the endothelial cells, when they become thick, they don't keep that direction up direction flow. Why it reverse? I will go and find out. And also, please, if you can find out also.
All right, thank you, doctor.
Welcome. Okay, so let's go to the clinical presentation. So tell me the clinical presentation. So usually it is asymptomatic or heart failure?
Asymptomatic.
Usually it is asymptomatic. Usually it is asymptomatic, unless it is very large. Okay. So, if heart failure happened, what are the symptoms of heart failure? So, you go to the frame and you tell the list. You tell about the feeding, if the child is in the first year of life, what happened to the feeding. You tell about the food intolerance. You tell about breathlessness, about failure to thrive. What signs? You tell about the signs of the heart failure in general. And here we have specific signs like we have wide fixed stability. Wide fixed stability. Wide fixed stability. So why wide fixed stability? You see the normal stability we said, aorta closes before the pulmonary artery. And it will be the dog. The second heart sound, instead of dog, it will be the dog. And wider during inspiration. Wider during inspiration, because we know during inspiration, there is drop in intra-thoracic pressure, so more venous return, pooling of blood in the lungs, and then the pulmonary artery will close later than the aorta. In case of ASD, because of this defect, there will be equalization of pressure in the right atrium and left atrium. There will be pressure equalization. This pressure equalization will keep the symplegic fixed throughout the cycle. It will not change. Normally, the symplegic is wider during inspiration. But here in ASD, because of the defect, the pressure equalized in both atrium. So it will be fixed either during inspiration or expiration. It will be always the same. It is always like this. The murmur will be ejection systolic murmur. Ejection systolic murmur. Ejection systolic murmur louder in the left upper sternal edge. Louder in the left upper sternal edge. Ejection, systolic murmur. What about second heart sound? Second heart sound will be loud because you have more blood coming, so the S2 will be louder. S2 will be louder, S1, and you'll have ejection systolic murmur. With time, if ASD is not corrected, if it is very large and it is not corrected, patient may develop the same murmur which happened in VSD. When we have more flow in the mitral. Oh, sorry, in this case, it is not in the mitral. In this case, in the tricuspid valve. With time, the flow in tricuspid valve here, it will cause mid-diastolic murmur. Mid-diastolic murmur. Mid-diastolic murmur. Okay. So this is regarding the clinical history and clinical presentation and physical examination of ASD. What about complications? Who will tell me complications of ASD? Yes, someone tell me complications of ASD.
It will give SNIT complication.
Yeah, complication. Yes, complication of ASD. So you go to the frame.
pulmonary hypertension, recurrent pneumonia, heart failure, infective endocarditis.
Yes.
And lastly, Ismail.
Ismail, yes, very good. Do you want to add something? Do you want to add one phrase or one sentence after you tell the complication is?
But it's rare and uncommon.
Yeah, exactly. You say rare. Rare or uncommon. So you mentioned the same list, but you tell it is rare or uncommon. Very good. So let's go to the chest X-ray. So the chest X-ray, first, it may be normal. Chest X-ray may be normal. Because like we said, AST most of the time, it is well tolerated. If the AST is very large, what we expect? We expect the cardiac size to increase. If there's heart failure, cardiomegaly, and increased pulmonary vascular markings, so it will be pleuritic lung. Pleuritic lung. No special changes. For ECG, do you expect left ventricular hypertrophy or right ventricular hypertrophy?
No.
Yeah, most of the time it will be normal. Most of the time it will be normal. If it is large, right. If it is large, it will cause right ventricular hypertrophy. One finding which you may see in ASD is right bundle branch block. Right bundle branch block. Which is benign. Right bundle branch block. It may be seen in ASD. Why right bundle branch block? Because of the increase the flow in the right ventricle. So it is seen as RSR pattern. RSR dash pattern in ECG. So in right ventricular leads, in right ventricular leads, right ventricular leads, which are V1, V2, and V3. So you will see normally this is QRS. This is the normal QRS. So here it will be like this. This is right bundle branch block. This is right bundle branch. And it was one of the cases in the exercise. One of the questions, many of you answered it correctly. Yeah, it is ASD. The one which caused right bundle branch block is ASD. And the cause of that is the increased volume in the right ventricle. The echo, so just you see the defect and be sure you don't have associated anomalies. Like we said, when it is sinus venosus, you need to look for the pulmonary veins because patient may have PA, BVR, partial anomalous pulmonary veins return when there it is sinus venosus. Cardiac catheterization, is it needed?
No.
No. Other investigations, do we need?
No.
Okay, let's go to treatment. So tell me how to treat ASD. Number one, do we need emergency prostaglandin?
No.
No emergency prostaglandin. Okay, so what do we need to do? Number one?
Prophylaxis against.
Yeah, prophylaxis against infective endocarditis. Number two?
Refer to the dietitian for nutritional care.
Yes, nutritional care, yes. We need to give low volume, high calories, and we may need to refer to dietitian. Number three?
Refer to pediatric cardiologist and cardiac surgery.
Yes, very good. Or intervention plan. Yeah, refer to pediatric cardiologist and cardiac surgeon for intervention plan. So medical treatment of heart failure is needed. We treat heart failure medically by diuretics, by ACE inhibitors, by spironolactone. Surgical treatment if needed, we go for surgery. What are the post-operative complications? Tell me postoperative complications. So see your frame, what are the postoperative complications?
Pleural effusion and pneumothorax.
Pleural effusion and pneumothorax.
Pericardial effusion.
Very good, pericardial effusion.
Arrhythmia.
Yeah. Arrhythmia.
Chylothorax.
Chylothorax, okay.
Vocal cord palsy.
Vocal cord palsy.
And Horner syndrome.
Okay, and Horner syndrome. Prognosis of ASD?
Good.
Prognosis of ASD is good. Yeah. Okay. Any question about ASD? I think I will stop after ASD. I still need to talk about coarctation of aorta, tetralogy of Fallot, and BDA. So we can arrange another time to talk about the three other conditions. After that, if you have other questions, you can share in the group, in WhatsApp. You can ask me at any time. Any questions for today?
Doctor?
Yes.
I want to ask, is ASD also common in PTE?
ASD common in?
ASD also common in TGA.
ASD, it may be associated with TGA, yes, it may have. Some patients with ASD or some patients with TGA, they may have ASD, yes. It is good. When you have TGA with ASD, you will be happy. Do you know why?
Because it can be doctor dependent. So in TGA, if the ASD is compatible with life.
Exactly. It is compatible with life. In fact, one of the operations for TGA, we do septosotomy. We open the septum. If the septum is closed, we open the septum. Yeah, we call it Rashkind operation. We open the septum. Some more, the advantage when you have ASD with TGA, you can do the operation later with no problems. Because the problem of TGA, you see, now when we have TGA, we have the right ventricle is the predominant one. Right ventricle is the predominant one. Because the systemic circulation, the aorta comes from out from the right ventricle. So the right ventricle will have structural changes. Already right ventricle is thicker in the newborn and it will be more thicker. So if in the normal condition, if there is no ASD and we delay the operation, when we make the operation, we change the aorta to the left ventricle, the patient will go into heart failure because the left ventricle has not enough muscles. The left ventricle is weak, is not adapted. So the operation may not be successful. That's why we need to go to the operation early before the right ventricle enlarges more and the left ventricle gets degeneration. We need to go earlier. But when you have ASD, the ASD will make some balance between the atria. So the left ventricle will get some blood comes from the mitral valve. So it will not be degenerated, it will grow. And on the other side, right ventricle will not enlarge too much. So you have time. You have a chance to delay the operation until the child grow. And of course, when the child grow and gains weight, the chance of successful operation will be better. So you will be happy. If they ask you, TGA with ASD or TGA without, say TGA with ASD is much better.
Okay, thank you, doctor.
Welcome. Yes, any other question?
Doctor, for ASD, if we do echocardiography, is there any special features that we can look for?
I don't know any special features in echocardiogram. Yeah, when we look for the echo, we see the size of the defect. Size of the defect. Like usual, we see the size of the defect. Yes, we see the function of the both ventricles. And we see the pulmonary artery pressure. So
and then in ASD, can you get a pan-systolic murmur?
Pan-systolic murmur, no. In ASD, there is no pan-systolic murmur. You get only ejection systolic murmur and mid-diastolic murmur.
Mid-diastolic murmur, okay.
Yeah.
Doctor, I found about some term called paradoxical system embolization. Can you explain about it?
Paradoxical?
Systemic embolization. I mean, when there is actually left to right shunt, but suddenly there is actually emboli that can cause stroke. Whether is it occur in ASD or not?
No, this one, it will not occur in ASD unless there is in Menger. Because in ASD, the shunt is left to right. And once it is left to right, it will be filtered by the lung. It will be filtered by the lung. So it will not go to the brain. It will not go to the stroke unless your patient develop Ismail. If your patient develop Ismail, then that may happen. The term paradoxical, I didn't hear about it before. Where did you find it?
You mentioned about association with isolated upper pattern from an ovale. So
yeah, well, from the basic what I know, it will not. It will not happen. So once you have normal ASD or beta foramen ovale, it is always left to right. Because it becomes right to left, the patient will be cyanotic. Patient will become cyanotic. So it will be Ismail. That time, yes, it may happen.
So meaning to say that in acyanotic heart disease, there will no risk of stroke. Am I right?
Yes, exactly. Yes. There will be no, if acyanotic, there will be no risk of stroke.
Another one question, doctor. Because you say that because due to IE, there will be a risk to get several abscess. But in acyanotic, although there is a risk of infective endocarditis, but because the shunt is left right, so there will be no risk of several abscess. Am I right?
Yes, you are right. You are right.
I'm just going to confirm. Thank you.
Any other questions?
I'd like to ask. In Nelson, it mentions that one of the complications is ASD, is arrhythmia, which can develop starting from 4 decade onwards. So what is the pathophysiology of ASD causing arrhythmia? How does ASD cause arrhythmia?
This one right under the branch of you mean the one in the ECG, is it? It is benign. Asymptomatic. Yeah, the pathophysiology is the increased load on the left, on the right ventricle. You see now, if we take ECG B. So the B wave is the arterial depolarization. This one is arterial depolarization, which originates in sinoatrial node here. So when you come to BR, BR is the AV node. BR interval is the conduction through AV node. This QRS is the ventricular depolarization. QRS is ventricular depolarization. So in ASD, because you have constant defect here and you have blood coming more, making more load on the right ventricle. So the depolarization process is disturbed. So that's why it is like some interruption here in the depolarization process. And instead of being just R, it will be R, this R. But it will be only ECG finding. It is not clinical finding. Mm-hmm. Is it clear?
Yes. Okay, doctor. Doctor, can right bundle branch block occur in normal children? the finding on ECG? Can it occur in normal children?
Right, bundle branch group can be normal variant. Yeah, it can be a normal variant. Yeah, when you go to tell about causes of right bundle branch group, so they will tell you like ASD may have, ABST and anomaly may have, coarctation of aorta may have, PABVR may have, and one of them also is a normal variant. Yes, normal variant can cause, can be right bundle branch group.
I see, okay. I have a second question. How does actually asymptomatic congenital heart disease causing recurrent chest infection?
The reason for recurrent chest infection, when you have increased pulmonary flow. When you have increased pulmonary flow, there will be a flooding of the lung. The lung is flooded. The lung is flooded with the flow. This flooding will affect the immune system, and it will enhance the bacterial infection.
Okay, thank you, doctor.
Welcome. Any other question? So if no other questions, see you inshallah next class. You can arrange the time when it is appropriate to talk about BDA, then coarctation of aorta, then tetralogy of Fallot, and after that, inshallah, we go through our exercise.
Okay. Doctor?
Yes?
Sorry, I have a last question. So, yes. And the doctor asked, what is the best to diagnose congenital heart disease? What is the best answer for that?
Again, what is the question?
If the doctor asks, how we diagnose congenital the heart disease, so what will be the best answer for that? Is it only by clinical and also investigation?
Diagnosis by echocardiogram, congenital heart disease, yeah. You have clinical suspicion, yes, you can diagnose clinically, but you have the physical signs, you have even typical signs, but confirmation of diagnosis by echocardiogram. For example, if you have coarctation of aorta, you have absent femoral pulse, you have high blood pressure in the upper limbus, or you have radiofemoral delay in the older children. Yes, that is typical for coarctation of aorta, but you cannot say coarctation without echocardiogram.
Okay. So you also on respective to the type of congenital heart disease, isn't it?
Sorry?
Also the diagnosis, it also goes to respective type of congenital heart disease.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
You can say I can suspect. You can tell the physical signs like that. You can tell about the presentation how, but confirmation without echo is not. We cannot label anyone with congenital heart disease unless we have the echo evidence.
Okay. Oh, so there is one question that you asked about when we suspect the patient having congenital heart disease. So in case of suspicious, so should we start to give the prostaglandin straight away?
If you suspect cyanotic congenital heart disease, straight away start prostaglandin. You see what I learned from the pediatric cardiologists, they told us when we work in area, when we don't have a good echo machine, or we don't have enough experience to see whether BDA is there or not, they tell us prostaglandin, if not useful, it is not harmful. So give prostaglandin. You give prostaglandin once you suspect congenital cyanotic heart disease. Or if your patient comes with shock. If your patient comes with shock also, because you know like the four conditions which come with obstructive shock, like coarctation of aorta, critical aortic stenosis, interrupted aortic arch, and hemiplastic left heart, they may be acyanotic. They may be without cyanosis. But why? Because they have ductal dependent systemic blood flow. Because ductal dependent, we have ductal dependent pulmonary blood flow for the cyanotic conditions like tetralogy of Fallot, pulmonary atresia, tricuspid atresia. These are ductal dependent pulmonary blood flow. But when you come to coarctation of aorta, severe coarctation, or critical aortic stenosis, it is ductal dependent systemic blood flow. So in case you see a patient with shock at age of 2 weeks, and you think it is obstructive shock, you see some signs of hepatomegaly and deviated apex beat, then it is reasonable to start prostaglandin to save the child.
Okay, okay. All right. Thank you, Doctor.
Doctor, so Doctor will to us regarding VSD, ventricular septal defect, is it important to differentiate between membranous and muscular type in if patient had VSD? And how do we know the type of VSD?
Without echocardiogram, you will not know. Without echocardiogram, you will not know. If the patient is asymptomatic patient driving well, has no signs of heart failure, and has very loud murmur, this is likely muscular. Likely muscular. The small ones usually muscular. So, in this case, of course, it has better prognosis because more chance to process continuously. If it is very membranous, we need to know whether it is infracrystal or supracrystal, because supracrystal may involve the aortic valve and the surgical supracrystal. That one would be important to know. If it is infracrystal, the surgery would be important.
Okay, thank you, doctor.
Okay. So, see you inshallah next class. You can tell me when you agree about the timing of the next class. Thank you all. Thank you. Thank you. I see. Thank you.
Thank you, doctor.
Thank you, doctor.
Thank you, doctor.
Have a nice
day.
Thank you, doctor.
Thank you, doctor.
Thank you so much, doctor.
Okay. Welcome.